Ich möchte jetzt zur Diskussion übergehen und bitte um die ersten Wortmeldungen.
Ja, also ich fand, jetzt ist er weg, wo ist der David Graeber? Ich wollte gerne eine Frage an ihn stellen. Wenn jemand vor mir sprechen möchte, der sich nicht mit David auseinandersetzen will, dann soll er das doch gerne jetzt tun.
Nee, komm, ich geh jetzt. Diese Seite, ich sage diese.
Thank you. I have a question to Silke Heifisch, actually two questions, regarding the commons and access to them. Regarding immaterial commons, like knowledge, know-how, etc., there are basically existing two concepts of granting access to them. One is called reciprocity licensing, roughly. The concept is that the entities which are classified as commons-oriented are granted the access for on the open basis. And I quoted this gentleman. Sorry. And other which are outside this group are supposed to pay in some form. So that means that if I am an entity and try to produce something based upon the knowledge commons, I will either have it for free or I will be supposed to pay depending on how I am classified by somebody. The other concept is so-called share alike license, which means that disregarding who I am, my access to the commons is open. However, I am requested unconditionally to provide the product of my work, which is derived from the commons, as a commons as well. So my question is, what is your opinion? Which of these two licenses fits better the anti-capitalist aspect of the commons? And the second question is much simpler, I guess, that we all know that the driving force of the Rojava revolution is its feminist aspect. So do you see any special relationship between commoning and feminism in this context? Thank you.
Oh my goodness, the first one, I want to, ich antworte auf Deutsch, Entschuldigung. Die erste Frage war sehr spezifisch und ich möchte vielleicht kurz den Kerngedanken wiederholen. Es ging um zwei verschiedene Lizenzen, die den Umgang mit in dem Commons produzierten Wissen regeln. Die eine nennt sich Commons-basierte Reziprozitätslizenz und die andere ist das Copyleft-Prinzip, das sogenannte Share-Alike-Prinzip. Und die Frage war, was ist kommunistischer? Und ich glaube, die Frage kann man nur als Transitionsfrage beantworten. Und man muss sie verbinden mit der Frage, zu welchem Zweck produziert wird. Wir leben in einem System, in dem, das haben wir von David Graeber nochmal gehört, sozusagen Produkte produziert werden, Dinge produziert werden. Und dieses Produzieren von Dingen, statt sozusagen die Reproduktion unserer eigenen Seinsweise, macht was mit uns. Und das Share-alike-Prinzip sagt nichts anderes als, Du kannst tun, was du willst. Du kannst produzieren, für welchen Zweck du auch immer willst. Hauptsache, du trägst auch was zum Commons bei, dann kannst du dich frei bedienen. Und das klingt frei, ist nicht dasselbe wie gratis. Und das klingt ein bisschen wie die kommunistischere Variante. Aber sie hat zwei Probleme. Die eine ist, dass man sich auch, wenn man sozusagen kapitalistische Warenproduktion betreibt, man sich frei in den Commons bedienen kann. Und damit den Bereich der kapitalistischen Warenproduktion auf Kosten der Commons ausweiten kann. Und das verschiebt nicht unbedingt die Kräfteverhältnisse und deswegen ist es nicht unbedingt der richtige Transitionsweg oder der einzig mögliche Transitionsweg. Und die andere Lizenz sagt, und das halte ich sozusagen in einer Situation, wo Commons schaffen von kapitalistischer Warenproduktion umgeben ist, für sinnvoll, wir müssen uns schützen. Wir brauchen Räume, wo wir diese Risse sozusagen entwickeln, Commons als Keimformen des Neuen entwickeln und das aber auch institutionell schützen müssen. Und die Reziprozitätslizenz ist ein Versuch, das zu schützen und sozusagen Mittel und Geld und Finanzen aus der Marktsphäre in die Commons hineinzuholen und trotzdem mit allen Commoners freizuteilen. Ich hoffe, das war einigermaßen klar, das war wirklich eine sehr spezifische Frage. Commoning und Feminismus, da müssten wir darüber reden, sozusagen, welche soziale Praxis in diesem Feminismus gemeint und benannt wird. Also wenn ich sozusagen Commons-Theorie und Feminismus vergleichen möchte, da glaube ich, dass es eine unheimlich große Schnittmenge gibt und dass diese grundlegenden sozusagen, das grundlegende Neuaufstellen von Begriffen und Kategorien, so wie es in der feministischen Ökonomie beispielsweise gedacht wird und wie das in der Commons-Debatte diskutiert wird, unbedingt zusammengehört.
Yeah, I had a couple of questions. One of them was for the woman from Greece. I don't know if she's in the room anymore, though. Okay, I'll save that one for her. But it's related to a broader issue having to do with the role of the state. Okay. So there she is. Okay, good. About the role of the state. Because one of the things about the revolution in Rojava is that many of the questions for those of us from advanced capitalist countries with respect to how we get from here to there are not on the agenda because the state effectively imploded or collapsed in Syria. And so this is a precondition for all kinds of revolutionary opportunities. But for those of us who live in states that are not close to collapsing, there's questions about how we get from the capitalist world that we live in to some sort of alternative. Precisely because a crucial role of the state is to enforce social property relations. So the question then is, for those of us who live in states that are relatively stable, what do we do with the state? So this brings me to the question for the Greek comrade here. So we have Syriza comes to power. Syriza is in the government. Should we, as revolutionaries, people who are concerned for transcendence of the capitalist order, should we see Syriza as an opportunity, or should we see, so the Syriza government, should we be supporting the Syriza government, or should we be thinking of Syriza as a problem insofar as a restorationist social democratic project which will not provide an alternative but will provide a more legitimate form of capitalism? With respect to the question in Rojava, related to this question of the state, interesting to me that I agree with you that it seems very important for the long-term sustainability of the revolutionary transformations that the revolution spread. But you mentioned it spreading to the rest of Kurdistan, and I wonder, it seems to me, because spreading to the rest of Kurdistan, given the existence of state boundaries, can be very difficult and, in fact, explosive. What about the rest of Syria? Is there any, what are the kinds of attempts to push the revolution beyond a Kurdish national imaginary into the rest of Syria? So those are my two questions.
I'm sorry, but I didn't hear your question from the start.
Okay, well, the question from the start is, given that the role of the state in the imposition of capitalist social property relations in places like Greece, the European Union generally. So we have now a moment in Greece where there's a government that comes to power, and people on the left are generally supporting the government, in the Syriza government. But from what you were saying, it seems like a very different kind of project from what the Syriza government is trying to implement. So what should the revolutionary left, what should its position vis-a-vis Syriza be?
It's a crucial issue because we don't know if now is the right moment. We never know if it's the right moment. You see that the movement when Syriza came at the governance, you saw that the movements are in retreat. Nobody is moving from that. Everybody is expecting the negotiations at the Europe. And this is a problem. Despite of that, I think it's a good time to work on other structures because the main problem exists. You have economical problem now, and this is a very nice way to influence people that didn't see it. They experienced it, but they didn't see the reason they have it. That's what I said. That the it's a nice time. It's nice time to work on these structures of another economy, so that to make another front even. If Syriza is at governance, because you can't expect from Syriza to do something at the decision making, for example. People are still waiting Syriza to take the decisions for us. Syriza, for example, wants to install big projects, energy wind farms projects in Crete, for example. This is something that Cretans don't want, and because they know the real problems that this could cause at this. So you always have this particular problem, this particular contrast, that the people who have to take the decisions It's not the subjects that do it. They are waiting for Syriza. I don't know. I think that it's better that we have right now Syriza to work on these structures, but not because Syriza will allow us to do it, but we will not have as circumstances all these. Sorry about for my English. Oppression, maybe. No. We will not have this oppression with everything, the privatizations. We have the time to work on the structures we want. That's the only reason I see as good that we have another government, for nothing more.
Pan, Sorunuza cevap verecek olursam, yani şöyle, siz mesela devleti iyi bir devlet olarak görüyorsunuz aslında Avrupa'da belki biraz. Çok iyi bilmiyorum aslında, ben sadece böyle olduğunu tahmin edebiliyorum. Ama hiç değilse hayatı bir şekliyle kolaylaştıran ve hani hukuk devleti normlarına biraz daha uyan bir devlet biçimiyle yüz yüzesiniz gelişmiş ülkelerde. Şimdi ben Türkiye'nin İstanbul şehrinde yaşıyorum. Benim orada gördüğüm devlet faşizan bir devlet. Yani kendini korumak için vatandaşına her şeyi yapabilecek bir devlet ki zaten siz de son iki yıldır Türkiye'de olanları görüyorsunuz. Diğer taraftan bir Kürt olarak Kürdistan'daki devlet benim için nasıl bir devlet diye sorarsanız bence oradaki devlet bütün oradaki Kürtler için sömürgeci bir devlet. Ve faşizmden çok daha derin pratikleri olan bir devlet biçimi. O yüzden de aslında Kürdistan'da devlet algısı, yani devleti kutsayan bir durum hiçbir zaman söz konusu olmadı. Bu bence Kürdistan'ın dört parçası içinde aslında böyleydi. Özellikle Rojava'da, hani biz biliyoruz ki Rojava'daki insanlar vatandaşlıktan dahi çıkarılan Kürtlerdi. Ben şey dediniz çok doğruydu, yani kuzey sahasında aslında çatlak yaratmak daha zor dediniz. Mesela bence Rojava böyle bir fırsata ve böyle bir umuda Kürdistan'ın kuzey sahasından çok daha fazla sahip. Çünkü oradaki doğal toplum yapısı dediğimiz işte daha tarım toplumuna dayalı bir yapı henüz çözülmüş değil. Ama kuzey sahasına bakacak olursak benim biraz Harvey'in çalışmalarıyla bütünleştirdiğim yani sermayenin coğrafyaya yayılma meselesini Kuzey Kürdistan'da çok rahat görebiliyorsunuz. Diğer taraftan mesela Kürt hareketi aslında yani kuzey sahasında Kürtler aslında 15 yıldır yerel yönetimler eliyle bir şekilde kendini yönetiyor. Ve orada aslında bir anladığımız anlamda bir devlet olmasa bile bir siyasal iktidar ve erk aslında yaratmış durumda. Şimdi mesela bence biz burada benim az önce bahsettiğim komünal ekonomi ya da komünal yaşamı hayata geçirebilmek için Türkiye devletiyle mücadele bunun bir alanıysa aslında kuzey sahasında kendi yarattığımız iktidar odaklarıyla gireceğimiz mücadele ve sermaye ile gireceğimiz mücadele de aslında bizim mücadelemizin önemli bir ayağı ve parçası olacak. Sonunda ne yaratacağız derseniz, yani sonunda bir devlet mi yaratacağız? Bir ulus devlet yaratmayacağız. En azından bunu biliyoruz. Ama daha toplumsal olan, daha topluma nüfuz eden, daha topluma yayılan, toplumun özneleştiği bir yönetim mutlaka ki ortaya çıkacak. Buna ne ad vereceğimiz, yani bir devlet demeyiz ama bir şekilde toplumu organize edecek bir yapıya bence orada da ihtiyaç duyulacak belki. Böyle diyebilirim. Teşekkür ederim.
Ben öncelikle teşekkür etmek istiyorum Azize Aslan'a. Bitti değil mi? Die Antworten sind fertig, oder? Zu der anderen Frage? Okay. Azize Aslan'a özellikle teşekkür etmek istiyorum. Ve bir şey sormak istiyorum ama Almanca da söyleyeceğim. Zaten tercüme ama. Da war ja die Aussage, dass Nordkurdistan der politische Wille da ist, aber die Ökonomie sozusagen die alternative Ökonomie noch nicht stark genug ist. Oder wie, also ich glaube, so ungefähr war das ausgedrückt. Und da frage ich mich, da gibt es ja Subsistenzwirtschaft ganz viel und auch die Gemeinden machen ja schon total viel auch in Richtung autonome Ökonomie, auch schon eine Weile. Und ob Sie denken, dass es einfach nicht radikal genug ist oder dass es einfach noch mehr Zeit braucht, damit es so die Stärke hat, die wir uns wünschen und die dann auch eine Auswirkung hat für den vor Ort.
ifade doğruydu. Yani ben hani siyasal anlamda kuzey sahasının güçlü bir politik düzeye sahip olduğunu ama alternatif bir ekonomik yaşam anlamında bunun yeterli olmadığını düşünüyorum. Bunun yani yeterli olmaması neyle ilişkili diye baktığımda, yani mesela biraz önce Bağlar Kadın Kooperatifine bağlandık. Bağlar Kadın Kooperatifi aslında kuzey sahasında ortaya çıkmış önemli bir deneyim. Aslında pek çok deneyim de yaşandı kuzey sahasında. Ama şöyle problemleri var mesela Bağlar Kadın Kooperatifinin. Örneğin Bağlar Kadın Kooperatifi işte çanta üreten, dikim yapan, küçük bir tekstil atölyesi gibi aslında çalışan ama komünal ve eşitlikçi bir temelde kendini örgütleyen bir kooperatif. Diğer taraftan Kürdistan'ın pek çok yerinde işte bal kooperatifleri var. Örneğin mesela kadınların bal üretimi oldukça yaygın bir şekilde gerçekleşiyor kooperatiflerle. Diğer taraftan süt kooperatifleri, örneğin kurutmalık sebze kooperatifleri var. Bu kooperatiflerin ama bir etkinleşememe durumu söz konusu. Bu etkinleşememe durumu şununla ilgili. Örneğin çok ciddi anlamda pazara ulaşabilme sıkıntıları var. Keza pazara ulaşsalar bile yani kapitalist fiyatlarla rekabet edebilecek bir düzeyleri söz konusu değil. Neden hani peki siyasal olan gücümüzü biz neden buraya doğru kanalize edemedik ya da 15 yıl, yani 10 yıldır yerel yönetimleri mesela buraya doğru daha fazla neden güçlendiremedik? Bunlar elbette ki çeşitli nedenlerle gerekçelendirilebilir. Ben şimdi biz yeni yeni tartışıyoruz yani bu alanı güçlendirmeyi yani elimizde olan bu siyasal gücü yaşamı yeniden organize etmek için kullanmayı nasıl yapabiliriz diye epey tartışmalar yürütüyoruz. Ben de bu tartışmaların içerisinde olan birisiyim aslında. Örneğin bizim için şu an çok acil ihtiyacı olan şey şu, yani bir sürü kooperatif var ama o kooperatifler birbirinden habersiz, o kooperatifler birbirini tanımıyor, onların birbiriyle ilişkilenebileceği, birbirini görebileceği, kendi aralarında bir mal takası yapabileceği, örneğin dün Harvey'in söylediği yani bu bir araç olur, yani para olmak durumunda değil, yeni bir para yaratabilirsiniz. Merkez Bankası tarafından basılmayan böyle bir parayla mesela kendi aralarında takaslarını yapabiliyor muyuz? Ya da örneğin Kürdistan toplumunu bu komün ve kooperatiflerde üretilen ürünleri tüketmeye yönelik seferber edebiliyor muyuz? Bunlar bizim için önemli. Yani bundan sonraki süreçte önümüze koyduğumuz hedefler bunlar. Bunu yapacağız. Yani Kürdistan toplumunu gerçekten komünal bir zihniyetle örgütleyeceğiz ve bu örgütlerde yani bu örgütlenmelerde ortaya çıkan üretimle aslında kendimizi var edeceğiz ve bir öz yeterliliğe dayalı bir toplum oluşturacağız. Bundan da başka çaremiz bence yok. Çünkü bugün ben hani görüyorum Kürdistan sokaklarını genç, yoksul kitleler dolduruyor. Yani artık bundan sonra onlara bir cevap, bir yaşam üretmezsek biz Kürdistan'da kendi kendimize yenilmiş olacağız zaten.
Hello. So my comment is perhaps a little out of context in continuation of the last few questions, but I'll go ahead anyway. And my question is for Penny Wonisu. Sorry for not pronouncing your name well. So there's a tendency amongst environmentalists, as well as leftists, I'd say, in Europe and the US, to not only view so-called renewable energy sources as a feasible alternative to other means of energy production, but also straight out call for them and promote them. And this is done in a context that completely disregards the role that these so-called renewable energy sources have in sustaining and perpetuating capitalism and imperialism and the ecological destruction that those power structures involve. So my question is, I take it for granted that you've experienced this in your struggle in Crete. So to what extent do you feel this lack of analysis and solidarity in your struggle in Crete? And also, if you like, how can we build a stronger sense of solidarity in the struggle against capitalism and get rid of these not in my backyard politics? Thank you.
I didn't understand from the start your question. I'm sorry.
I'm talking about, I'm asking about this lack of anti-capitalist analysis that is quite common amongst environmentalists today. In when people are promoting these so-called green or so-called renewable energy sources as an alternative, while disregarding how renewable energy sustains capitalism. Could you elaborate on that a bit?
Would I?
Could you talk a bit about that?
Yes. They promote it as a broad government, promote it as a green development for Greece, if I have understood your question. But people who live there can say that this is not green because Crete is full of wind farms. In natura places, at forests, it's the farms that is in an industrial scale. So it takes a lot of land, so it stops other productive activities like agricultural production. First, and the second and main thing, except from the environmental consequences, is that all these are one step for the main step of privatization of energy and of water together. So all these companies will work. Am I answering to your question? all these companies do this for their profits, and it's not for us to have green energy. This is the main theme, except from the environmental consequences. And the problem is that during the economical crisis, even we had, even if we have a left party or a right party, this will be also be promoted as we have to do it for the growth of the economy. So you have two poles to fight.
I have a question to Silke. I'm sorry, I missed the first part of the speech, so maybe it was talked, and so if it's a repetition for some of you, I'm sorry about it. I was quite confused about the meaning of the commons. If you're talking about some goods, some certain goods, or if you're talking about a regime. And since you talk about the ownership structures, I understood that you're talking about a regime. And I would like to then ask what are the challenges and what are the complications of transition of a regime from a private to common one. And I also would like to ask, because there's another different definition of collective action, so to say, the supply or the contribution to the commons. So I also didn't understand the difference or similarity between the commoning and collective action. So thank you.
Yes.
Also vielleicht ganz grundsätzlich glaube ich, dass es die eine Definition von Commons nicht gibt, sondern was wir gerade erleben ist, dass auch die Definition, also das Versuchen, Commons begrifflich zu fassen, selbst ein Commons ist, also ein Prozess, der an vielen Orten der Welt ganz praktisch, theoretisch und praktisch stattfindet und sich quasi herauskristallisiert. Was ich aber sehr sicher sagen kann, ist, nein, Commons sind keine Güter. Commons fallen nicht vom Himmel, sondern die werden gemacht. Und dieses Machen ist ein sozialer Prozess. Und dieser soziale Prozess, den nennen wir Commoning, und der kann sozusagen begünstigt werden durch Institutionen, die Commons erleichtern und auch wieder sicherstellen, dass Commons auch Commons bleiben. Das war die Bedeutung der Frage nach den Lizenzen. Bei dieser Frage nach den Lizenzen geht es darum, wie stellen wir sicher, dass etwas, was wir als Commons in die Welt gebracht haben, auch Commons bleiben. Das heißt, manchmal argumentiere ich mit so einem Dreieck. Natürlich geht es in der Frage der Reproduktion unserer Lebensverhältnisse oder unseres menschlichen Seins, ist ja auch immer ein Stoffwechselprozess. Also wir greifen immer auch auf natürliche Ressourcen zu und so. Also gibt es da Dinge, die im Mittelpunkt stehen, zu denen wir uns ins Verhältnis setzen? Nicht allein, nicht als Privateigentümer, sondern in anderen vielgestaltigen gemeinschaftlichen Eigentumsverhältnissen? Und in diesen Prozessen müssen wir Regeln und Normen aushandeln, sodass sich niemand über den Tisch gezogen fühlt. Und dieses alles, dieser soziale Prozess, das ist ein Commons, das sozusagen immer im Werden ist. Im Grunde kann man Commons nur als prozessoralen Begriff fassen. Ich hoffe, das war einigermaßen klar.
Ja. Also meine erste Frage richtet sich an die Frau Aziz Aslan. Sie haben von der, ich möchte langsam reden, damit er übersetzen kann. Sie haben von kommunaler Ökonomie gesprochen. Es geht darum, in der kommunalen Ökonomie, wenn die Produkte produziert werden, müssen bestimmte Preise festgelegt werden. Nach Ihrer Auffassung, was ist das Basis für diese Preisbildung, wenn die Preise gebildet werden, wenn Sie Arbeitswerttheorie leugnen, nicht mehr akzeptieren? Was soll der Basis sein, wenn die Preise gebildet werden? Das ist eine. Und zweite Frage geht an David Kracher. Ob er eine Vorstellung hat, wie die Preise von Waren gebildet werden können, ohne Arbeitswerttheorie Referenz zu nehmen. Das waren die zwei Fragen. Dankeschön.
Ja, ich glaube, ich bin dran.
Wollen wir nicht jetzt mal die Frage beantworten?
Achso, okay.
Fiyatlar nasıl belirlenecek? Önemli bir soru elbette ki. Yani kapitalist sistem içerisinde hani Marx'ın bahsettiği aslında emek değer kurumu çerçevesinde de belirlenmiyor. Pazarda farklı faktörler var aslında fiyat üzerinde etkili. Hani komünal ekonomide nasıl fiyat belirlenecek? Bu noktada aslında ben şahsen kendim çok kafa yordum mu? Aslında yormuş değilim ama hani bence fiyat belirlemesi toplumsal ihtiyaçlar temelinde üretilen ürünlere göre belirlenecek. Bunda da meclislerde aslında toplumlar yani mesela örneğin bir komün ürettiği ürüne kendi fiyatını kendi komününün ait olduğu, kendi komününün içerisinde olduğu mecliste diğer komün ve kooperatiflerdeki diğer insanlarla beraber müzakere ederek karar verecek gibi geliyor bana. Herhalde komünal ekonomideki en doğru ve en doğru yol bu olabilir diye düşünüyorum.
Yeah, that sounds reasonable. I would say, first of all, you know, it's not as if prices are determined by labor values now. They're not. As I was pointing out, if anything, there's an inversion between the actual value of labor and how much money you get for it. So it's not as if we're moving away, we'd have to give up the system we have now where value is determined by labor. On the other hand, it's also true that prices right now are not actually set by markets. That's the right-wing illusion. If you look at people who've analyzed it, have figured out that about 20% of the price of the average object that you buy is determined by markets. The rest is through various forms of bureaucratic administrative systems, agreements between corporations, government. There's a million different factors. And also moral standards. That's why, you know, there's a sense of what a haircut should cost or what an umbrella should cost. And even if it's raining, the price of umbrellas doesn't normally go up in the store. So I mean, I think we need to recognize that prices now are largely set through negotiations according to certain moral standards, and supply and demand is, you know, it's a factor in there that would be figured in any democratic system, such as they're trying to create in Rojava. But at the same time, it would probably, you know, at the same time, it would probably be as minor a factor as it is now, which isn't a big one.
Ja, vielen Dank erstmal für alles. Meine Frage richtet sich an Herrn Graeber und an die Frau Helfrich. Und zwar auch in Bezug auf, also ein bisschen, damit man das ein bisschen eingrenzen kann, in Bezug auf moderne westliche Gesellschaften. Und zwar so in Bezug auf gestern und heute habe ich so für mich verstanden, dass da Widersprüche, krisenhafte Widersprüche zwischen, nennen wir Struktur, Gesellschaftsordnung oder System und zwischen dem Sein, dem Menschen, dem Individuum, und es wird eine, naja, moralisch-politische Verantwortung, nennt das Öcalan zum Beispiel, also es wurden auf verschiedene, von verschiedenen Referenten und mit verschiedenen Begrifflichkeiten eigentlich dasselbe verlangt, eine moralisch-ethische Verantwortung oder eine Umorientierung, also eine wertebasierte Orientierung. Meine Frage ist, welche Mechanismen, welche, ich will nicht sagen Instanzen, aber was wäre in der Lage, so einen sozialen Wandel, wie Frau Helfrich es eben meinte, sowas, was eigentlich auch in uns steckt, irgendwie aktivieren kann, veräußerlichen kann, wenn nicht die Orientierung an etwas Höherem, nennen wir es, man nennt das irgendwo, irgendwie, was weiß ich wo, aber auch irgendwie Liebe oder Gemeinschaftlichkeit, also letztendlich metaphysisch oder transzendent und im letzten Schritt religiös. Sehen Sie irgendwelche Potenziale darin? Also im Mittleren Osten verwirft man diese Dinge, aber ich habe so das Gefühl, dass hier irgendwie wieder ein Comeback von sowas, naja.
Gut. David?
De l'amour.
Um, Ich finde das eine super Frage, weil mich das nochmal den Punkt machen lässt, dass ich zum Beispiel das Wort Moral gar nicht in den Mund genommen habe. Weil sich ja dann automatisch die Frage stellt, wo soll denn die Moral herkommen? Fällt die dann vom Himmel? Hat die uns der liebe Gott vorgeschrieben oder sorgt eben sozusagen Vater Staat? Mein Beispiel war ja die Erziehung zur sozialistischen Bürgerin dazu. Und das halte ich nicht für praktikabel. Und was ich derzeit glaube, ist sozusagen das Handeln auf Augenhöhe tatsächlich aus dem sozialen Prozess heraus entsteht und immer wieder entstehen muss. Also auch in diesem Sinne, dieses Bestehen auf sozusagen Verhältnisbezüglichkeit, auf Relationalität, auf ein Ich, das ja selbst schon ein relationaler Begriff ist, weil es den Begriff des Ichs ja nur sozusagen dadurch gibt, dass es auch einen Begriff des Dus gibt. Und sich so in die Welt zu stellen und aus diesem in die Welt stellen heraus sozusagen in dem, was wir miteinander für Probleme lösen müssen, das Richtige zu finden, das sage ich jetzt mal, Gute oder moralisch Gute oder so zu finden. Weil das verdammt schwierig ist, sich in solchen Prozessen sozusagen auf Augenhöhe diesem zu entziehen, weil ich mit dir verbunden bin. Ich weiß nicht, ob ich das deutlich gemacht habe. Und der Punkt, den ich vorhin noch vergessen habe, ist, es ist tatsächlich so, dass ich das, was ich da mit Augenhöhe meine, nicht auf ein einander am Tisch gegenüber sitzen und in kleinen Communities alles zu besprechen, was man zu besprechen hat, meine, sondern dass man, wenn man das so denkt, alles als Commons denken kann. Alles kann Commons werden, wenn wir uns sozusagen auf diesen Grundgedanken Kooperation ist in uns angelegt und es geht darum, in der Bildung, in den Institutionen und so weiter, diese Facette unseres Diamantseins gewissermaßen zu schleifen und zum Glänzen zu bringen. Also es ist ja beides in uns. Auch das andere ist in uns, das Konkurrieren ist in uns. Und was wir derzeit tun, ist es ständig zu schleifen und zu feilen und uns fit zu machen für den Markt. Und dann reden wir von uns selbst, als wären wir eine Ware, indem wir uns am Arbeitsmarkt verkaufen und so. Und wenn wir all unsere Kraft da reinstecken, soziale Prozesse, Institutionen und insbesondere auch Kommunikation und die Art, wie wir sprechen, sozusagen zu entkapitalisieren, dann kommt dieses auf Augenhöhe das richtige Tun tatsächlich immer wieder neu in die Welt, nicht ein für alle Male, weil es in der Verfassung steht oder in der Bibel, sondern wir selbst müssen es immer wieder neu in die Welt bringen.
Yeah, I don't have much to add. I started by talking about value and values that we currently separate, and we have to collapse that. I think that's the task in front of us. And in a lot of ways, we don't know what a free life would be like. What we're doing now is creating the institutions that we can think about it. Because, you know, the key work is to destroy the sort of conceptual barriers that make it impossible for us to even imagine what a free life would be like. And once we've done that, then we, you know, once we have institutions where we can talk to each other, you know, we can begin to actually think about what those institutions would really be like. How would we think about measuring things? What is the relation of love and need? What are humans, you know? In a way, we don't even know what we are. I've always, when you talk about are we individuals, are we just the relations we have with others, how do we understand that? I've always been very impressed by the fact that the worst thing you can do to a prisoner is put them in isolation. You know, I mean, if you put someone in a solitary confinement after 3-4 months, their brain starts to show damage. You know, we can't actually survive without other people, or else we decay immediately. So as entities, you know, pure individual, alone person would just sort of fall apart. there's physical brain damage. On the other hand, if you have people all the time, you go crazy. I've always felt that's why we need to sleep. And so, you know, the way we have to, we don't even realize what we actually are as human beings, or what, and I think that's what we're in the process of beginning to reinvent now, to understand what we really are in a free process of exchange.
Hey,
Moment noch, eine kurze Ankündigung, wir haben noch circa 10 Minuten, okay? 10 Minuten noch.
My question is about prefiguration in the context of Rojava, so it's kind of to Graeber or whoever wants to answer it. I'm going to start with commodity fetishism, because the point of commodity fetishism, as I understand it, is that the world appears to be run by things and not by people, and that is an illusion. But it is also an illusion that has power. A pile of money might in reality be worthless paper, but it can really, in the context of capitalism and our system, get people to do things, for example, kill other people. This relates to the phenomenon of bullshit jobs, because it sounds like the jobs are arbitrary, but they are not. Companies know very well what is good for their bottom line. So the jobs are not bullshit within capitalism. It's capitalism that is bullshit. So as long as all resources of value to humans that we need to reproduce ourselves are controlled by capital, we can't just stop being telemarketers because we need to reproduce ourselves. So we can only stop the bullshit if we expropriate capital. And that's what I thought was kind of missing from a lot of the contributions, expropriating the expropriators. To me, that is also one of the lessons of Rojava. It's that we can only talk about creating commons if in the same swing we talk about abolishing private property and taking back the land. So otherwise, I think we're only dreaming.
Okay. Why don't I start, since some of that was to me, and then someone else can take it. But I think the first thing about expropriation is it's not like we haven't got to that. We're assuming that. I mean, I think that the starting point is creating, you know, you create a commons out of something. at the moment, capitalists own all that stuff. The question is not that it's left out, it's just we don't think that's enough. We have to think about what happens then, how not to create a bureaucratic state that will administer that what you've expropriated. As for BS jobs. Actually, I don't think that's true. It's true. Telemarketers, corporate lawyers, corporations need them because other corporations use them. In the similar way that armies are unnecessary, but if the state next door has an army, you have to have one too. But a lot of bullshit jobs is rent distribution. It doesn't actually do anything. What they do is it's taking the profits from rent extraction and redistributing them to a section of the population which would otherwise be unemployed and angry, and which is thus put in a position where they identify with the perspectives of management. So it's actually a political thing, because you can't separate the political and the economic in the form of capitalism we have now, where the state profits are extracted through the state as more than they are indirectly through the wage. A form of capitalism has changed. But in terms of prefiguration and Rojava, I mean, Rojava has the advantage that the capitalist class ran away. They didn't have to expropriate it. It was there, about 50% of everything for the taking. So that's one reason why this revolution is possible. But in terms of to continue, let someone else take it from there.
Übrigens habe ich jetzt endlich verstanden, wie man das schafft, hier oben auch zu verstehen, was Sie sagen. Danke, es war ein bisschen spät. Ich Ich glaube, also nur zwei Punkte, die ich ergänzen möchte zu dem, was schon gesagt worden ist. Ich habe ja diesen Eigentumspunkt gemacht. Ich möchte nur noch ergänzen, dass es nicht ein Zuerst und Danach gibt oder so, sondern in der derzeitigen Situation, wo die Enteignungsprozesse so subtil laufen, dass wir sie noch nicht einmal mitkriegen und als Enteignungsprozesse wahrnehmen. In der Commons-Diskussion nennt man das Enclosures. Ist es erstmal wichtig, dafür wieder ein Bewusstsein herzustellen? Also warum ist es denn wichtig, sozusagen sich gegen TTIP zu stellen? Doch nicht aus Gründen der Gesundheitsstandards für Produkte, die künftig in Europa verkauft werden oder wegen des Chlorhühnchens, sondern weil da Enteignungsprozesse und Konzentrationsprozesse stattfinden, die uns jegliche Macht über die Selbstgestaltung von Ökonomie, Gesellschaft, Kultur, was auch immer nehmen. Also da geht es zunächst mal um Widerstand. Und in der Commons-Diskussion geht es ganz viel um Wiederaneignung. Und das ist klar, insofern müssen wir erst mal was haben, auf das wir dann gestalten können. Das wurde schon gesagt. Was ich aber gerade mit der Erfahrung von 1989 noch wichtig finde, ist 1989 ist auch plötzlich was weggerannt. Nur nicht die Kapitalisten, sondern sozusagen die DDR-Regierung. Das ging ganz fix. Und dann hat eine gesellschaftliche Diskussion eingesetzt, wie man das jetzt anders gestalten kann, und zwar innen. Und die hat nur 6 Monate gedauert und dann war Schluss. Und es gab zu wenig gemeinsames Nachdenken darüber, was eigentlich danach kommen kann und wie man sich überhaupt Freiräume und Zeit verschaffen kann, um darüber nachzudenken. Und auch das ist wieder kein Entweder-Oder und ein Zuerst und Danach, sondern das muss immer alles gleichzeitig passieren. Also Widerstand, zum Beispiel in der Commons-Diskussion haben wir ganz viele, gerade in Mitteleuropa, Versuche, Land gemeinschaftlich überhaupt wieder aufzukaufen. Und da brauchen wir dann aber Modelle, die sichern, dass wenn das Land gemeinschaftlich aufgekauft ist, es nicht wieder zurück an den Markt fällt. Und es ist eine unglaublich schwierige, konzeptionelle und auch rechtliche Arbeit, die getan werden muss. Und das muss alles gleichzeitig stattfinden. Also Widerstand, Wiederaneignung und gleichzeitig konzeptionelles Denken nach vorn und dabei aus der Praxis immer wieder reflektieren, geht denn das überhaupt unter den Bedingungen, in denen wir uns gerade befinden?
Okay, letzte Frage bitte, ja? Letzte Frage. Letzte, ja? Es ist schon 14 Uhr.
Faccio io? Innanzitutto volevo spiegare perché sono qua. Io vengo dall'Italia e I know. I asked before, but she said okay. Okay. Okay. Vengo dall'Italia e sono venuta qua sicuramente per conoscere di più sull'esperienza del Rojava e dell'esperienza delle donne nel Rojava. Quindi accolgo anche la domanda di come pensare una sussistenza anche al di fuori di questa della loro situazione. Dove penso che siano state bravissime e che abbiano e che saranno sicuramente di ispirazione per noi che viviamo comunque tutta un'altra realtà. La cosa che più sarà di ispirazione per noi è il fatto che con un'apertura alle donne si è creato abbastanza in fretta un'organizzazione e un'autocoscienza femminile, e l'autocoscienza è uno dei punti forti del femminismo, cioè in un non detto le donne si ritrovano e dicono. Credo che questo si possa applicare anche al discorso del capitalismo. I primi luoghi da rendere common siamo noi stessi, perché noi riproduciamo introiettati gli stessi meccanismi che ha anche il capitalismo, finché vediamo il capitalismo e noi come altro dal, difficilmente riusciremo ad avere qualche successo in questo senso. E sicuramente vedere come le donne, anche storicamente, oltre voi, rispondono sempre a questi spazi di apertura che si devono creare, e poi bisogna essere pronti, ma prima si deve creare lo spazio. Io vengo da un paese tremendamente in crisi e la perdita del lavoro mi ha aperto degli universi di pensiero, di libertà, di ripensare anche la mia realtà, e sono delle grandi opportunità, sono delle opportunità che bisogna tenere presenti per coglierle quando succedono, senza cadere nella disperazione. E questo era per dire un attimo la situazione. Invece sul discorso che ha fatto David, il resto non lo leggo, è vero che ci sono state tante femministe marxiste, hanno fatto una bellissima analisi di che mancava nel marxismo, insomma, un po' praticamente. Però esiste una letteratura che forse non arriva nelle accademie, ed è una letteratura, quando chiedevi ma ci siamo mai chiesti cosa desideriamo, noi donne ce lo siamo chiesto, perché c'è stata una grande letteratura sulla politica del desiderio, cioè indipendentemente da quello che dobbiamo fare, noi abbiamo dovuto rimparare a desiderare dei valori, delle cose. L'ultima cosa, se a qualcuno interessa, il 24-25 aprile a Roma, alla Casa Internazionale, c'è invece tutto il discorso sulla gift economy della Genevieve Vaughan, che ha scritto un libro per donare col doppio significato, una critica femminista dello scambio, e lì si capisce molto bene il denaro come significante, e indipendentemente da se uno vuol seguire un'economia del dono o no, però per trovare un'alternativa al denaro e ai rapporti economici, credo che sia un testo che va letto, una conferenza a cui si può partecipare. Grazie. Grazie a voi soprattutto.
What was that for me? Oh, yeah. No, she's great. I like her work a lot. There's enormous different debates within Marxist and other feminist literature about these things. Different takes on what communism, what gift economy, what and so forth would mean. And these are incredibly important. I'm particularly, personally, very most interested in, or been most influenced by, the sort of post-workerist, autonomous feminist tradition. People like Maria Rosa de la Costa, Silvia Federici, so forth and so on. But I think that this is exactly the sort of thing that needs to be reintroduced into larger economic debates, because there's been a terrible tendency to ghettoize feminist theory. I'm an anthropologist, for example, and we used to study kinship. That was the big thing. And then, you know, in the 70s, feminist anthropologists came and said, you can't look at kinship without looking at patriarchy and gender and power. And anthropologists said, okay, we'll let you do that. And now anthropologists, you know, feminist anthropologists study kinship, and the male one stopped. This is a disaster. And that's the kind of thing we need to counteract. We need to un-ghettoize this discourse and bring it back into the larger debate.
Ich wollte eigentlich nur sagen, dass man das nicht besser ausdrücken kann, als Sie das gerade gemacht haben. Ja? Also der erste Ort, den wir sozusagen zum Commons machen müssen, sind wir selber, weil das nochmal diesen Punkt macht, dass Kommunifizierung, wie ich das nenne, durch unseren Körper geht. Also diese Dimension sozusagen, was macht das eigentlich mit unserem Körper, ist hier noch gar nicht besprochen worden und Sie haben das damit zumindest angedeutet. Danke.
Ja, also ich danke jetzt auch allen Diskussionsteilnehmern und ich beschließe halt die Diskussion. Und